2022 was a record-breaking year for the rental market, with low availability and prices hitting boiling point in most major cities across Australia. Sadly, though, there doesn't seem to be an end in sight to this crisis, with many open homes this year being overrun with eager renters. For more this morning, we're joined by the Executive Director of Better Renting, Joel Dignam. Joel, good morning to you. We've seen these videos, Instagram, you know, Twitter, Facebook, long lines everywhere at rental inspections. How bad is it out there right now?
It's really bad out there right now. There's various ways this is harming people. When you see rent increases like this and this sort of competition, one of the effects is that more people end up homeless. They might be in a car, sleeping on a friend's couch in between having a rental in one place and trying to find the next rental. But even when you get that place, you might end up getting a place that's a substandard. We know lots of renters forced to live with mould, for example, because it was the only place they can get. Or the sheer rental cost means it's harder to afford other basics in your life. So you might end up cutting back on medication or even having to eat less to get through the week.
Yeah, it's a sad state of affairs, really worrying. Why do you think we're seeing these problems, put simply?
Put simply, I think there's two things. The root cause is that we've turned homes, which should be a place for people to live, to make memories, to create a family, into assets that people are trying to get rich on. And if people actually want to live in them, that makes life harder. And then because of that, we have a suite of laws that allow these sorts of rent increases that we're seeing that don't allow the building of more affordable supply to help address the lack of supply that's out there.
So is there something the government or governments need to do to bring rents under control? How can they help?
All governments can help with addressing this. So we're seeing increasing leadership from the Commonwealth, and we'd love to see them working with state and territory governments to be building more public and social housing, helping to increase the supply for people who really can't afford it in the private rental market. State governments can also play a role in looking at their rental laws. In particular, they can try to tamp down some of the excessive rent increases that we've been seeing, but also to get rid of unfair evictions. We hear about renters who are being kicked out just so the landlord can increase the rent. If we can actually keep that person in their home, that's one household that we've helped to protect from that.
So just say I was to head out this morning, you know, to a property, inspect it. What advice would you have for me to secure that property?
Well, I hope you'd be dressed that sharp for one.
That'd help. Bit of a smile as well.
Absolutely. I think you want to make a positive impression. It can be hard when there's a lot of competition and sometimes it really doesn't feel worth it. But obviously, if they can remember your name, give a smile. Also, try looking further abroad. You might want to look in a slightly different suburb or try to find a private landlord perhaps you can rent from directly. There are some risks there, but when there's fewer renters at the inspection, you obviously have a better chance.
And just very quickly, people are actually paying more than what's advertised, like trying to bid for the property. Is that right?
Yes. Look, it happens out there. People, it's really competitive. You want a way to make yourself stand out, and that can result in these sorts of secret auctions going on. It's a symptom, really, of the pressure that people are facing.
Hey, Joel, great advice. Thanks so much for joining us on Today.
It's time now for Today Property Watch, and getting into the New South Wales property market will soon be a whole lot easier with the government's first home buyer choice scheme to take effect from Monday.
So here to break it down and explain whether this could be right for you is Domain property editor Alice Stoltz, who joins us from Melbourne. Alice, good morning. Firstly, help explain what this scheme means.
Good morning, guys. Yeah, in New South Wales, from next week, first home buyers will have the option of either paying a property tax annually for the life of the property or paying stamp duty. Now, this is going to apply to properties under $1.5 million, only for individual buyers. You have to be over 18 and you have to live in that property for around 12 months' time. Now, it's great news for first home buyers because we know that stamp duty just adds into that cost of buying a property. It's around 4% the price of a property stamp duty, and it is one of the biggest hurdles when it comes to first home buyers being able to access properties.
But stamp duty is a one-off payment. If you choose the tax option, you have to pay it every year for the rest of the time you have the property. How do you decide which option is best for you?
Jane, great question. There's a few things to consider here. A lot of it's going to be along how long you plan to live in the property for. So if you're weighing it up, check the criteria of are you eligible or not. You need to work out how long you're going to live in that property for, whether it's an owner-occupier property or an investment property, as well as understanding your borrowing capacity. But we can see here, based on the Domain data, if you buy a $1.5 million house, which is around the median house price in Sydney at the moment, it will take you 18 years to pay the stamp duty of what that will will be in the property tax. So you can actually understand that if you're a first-home buyer, and most first-home buyers probably sell around after around 7 to 8 years in a property. So if you sell sooner than that, it is actually cheaper to buy, to use property tax than pay stamp duty. If you're going to live in that house forever and ever and ever, it's probably worth paying the stamp duty up front. But again, it is understanding, do you have the finances of money available to pay that stamp duty, which is often dubbed the laziest tax around and one of the most toughest hurdles.
Hey, Alice, this is all well and good if you live in New South Wales. What about elsewhere around the country?
Yeah, look, Sydney's obviously our biggest property market, so we do know that often what can happen in New South Wales, other states will follow. And I think what it could do is put a bit of sibling rivalry between states. So if this does actually work, and of course New South Wales is coming into an election this year, so this could well be rolled back if there is a change of government. But it could actually make other states lead the way and work out what to do when it comes to stamp duty in the other states. So there's hope that it will actually encourage other states to review their current policies around this tax.
We all love to do a little bit of property dreaming on a Saturday morning. So you've got this week's most expensive home up for sale. What can you tell us?
Guys, let's go for a bit of a dream now. We're going to go up to Broadbeach on the Gold Coast. This is an amazing house. I know. Wouldn't it be nice, Clint? It sold for $7.3 million. It's the ultimate beachfront penthouse. It's in a block of 7 apartments, 1 apartment per floor. But this one, the penthouse, has level 7 and level 8. Beautiful little bar in there, amazing views throughout. Now, onto our most affordable property. Well, this is the most affordable under the $400,000 price bracket. It's in Belconnen in Canberra. Now, what I like about this is Canberra this week we saw was the most expensive place to rent in the country. But for $390,000, you could potentially get an investment property like this, one bedroom, one bath, knowing that you are going to be able to command quite high rents in return for it, which is obviously what's appealing to a lot of investors at the moment.
Okay, Alice, hit it. What's the wow home you've got for us this weekend?
Clint, we're going to go back to Victoria. So we're going to look at Sorrento, which is this beautiful Mediterranean-style house. I mean, in one of the most, arguably, Point King Beach, which is one of the most beautiful spots in Sorrento. Mediterranean-style villa, all the bells and whistles that you could actually probably think you're in the south of France with a house like this. And if that doesn't whet your appetite, we could also go over to WA. Now, this is a place in Siesta Park, which is near Busselton in WA, not far from Margaret River. Beautiful property here, ultra-modern, sustainably built. So this is a trend we're seeing more and more, people wanting to sort of have a home that doesn't leave a huge footprint on the earth. And look at, I mean, how amazing. You could literally be in the beach in probably about 2 minutes, I reckon, with
a house
like that.
You can see Jane on her banana lounge right there.
Oh, thanks, Alice. You've given us something to dream about. It's not going to happen, but it'd be nice.
Rising grocery prices has impacted most Aussie wallets at the checkout, but there are hopes things will be a little easier this year. Natasha Kramer joins us from Brisbane this morning. Natasha, what's changing?
Good morning, Lizzie. Well, we've seen those prices skyrocket over the past few years, but we're being warned that we haven't hit our peak just yet. However, experts are predicting we will start to see those pressures ease. It was pretty much a perfect storm. We had the pandemic, war in Ukraine, as well as mass flooding events right across the country. We're being told that La Nina is starting to pass, and that will help with some of those supply pressures. So what can we expect from those shopping basket staples for 2023? Well, fruit and vegetables, we won't see those prices ease any time until mid-year, but they will sort of stabilise and we can't expect any increases from then on. As for red meats, well, the drought in the US, we're told that is also starting to ease, so those prices will sort of stabilise around mid-year as well. Those pantry staples, things like pasta, oils and canned goods, they'll sort of ease off as well around that mid-year and not expected to increase or decrease, whereas dairy products like milk, we're not too sure where those prices will go as suppliers pass on those price rises to consumers. So a very mixed bag for supermarket shoppers this year, Lizzie, but there will be some relief come mid-year.